It is my privilege on behalf of the entire seminary community to welcome all of you tonight, family and friends of these graduates of last year, 2020, and as well this year, 2021. We rejoice together in God's grace in the life of each of these graduates. We come tonight to give him praise and to thank him for the way he equips and furnishes his church with servants who will go out into the field of harvest. As we begin these exercises, let's seek the Lord's blessing and his presence in prayer. Our Father in heaven, we praise you, for you are the God of our salvation, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. You are the one who from all eternity purposed to present to your Son, and through his work and by his outpoured Spirit, to gather to yourself a people from every tribe, tongue, people, and nation. And you are pleased to use human instruments, those whom you call, who are raised up from within the church, to go into the field of harvest of which you are Lord, to gather through the ministry of the Word and the working of your Spirit all those whom you have chosen unto everlasting life. We praise you that we can mark this particular occasion in the life of these graduates from last year and this year. We're grateful for the way you have prepared them, have watched over them, and have brought them to this point. We pray that the word that is spoken through Dr. Camden Busey, that all of the elements and components of our commencement exercises may truly give expression to our gratitude to you, our need for your blessing and your help. And as we mark the accomplishments of these graduates, may we do so praising you and giving thanks for them. And so be with us and bless us, we pray, in Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated.
Dr. Camden Busey is an Illinois boy, not far from here. He graduated from Bradley with a couple of degrees and worked at Caterpillar in Peoria. And then he moved to Philadelphia to attend Westminster Theological Seminary, where he got an MDiv and ultimately his PhD, particularly in concentration in systematic theology. In April 2013, Camden was ordained and installed as the pastor of Hope Orthodox Presbyterian Church in Grays Lake, Illinois. And in July 2019, he transitioned to become an evangelist of Hope OPC and become the executive director of Reformed Forum online. You may be familiar with that. I'm sure he'll give you the web address in just a minute. He's married to Erica, and they have three sons. He enjoys, among other things, hunting, the outdoors, and the Cubs, the latter of which especially highlights his excellent taste and judgment. Camden's connection with Mid-America is severalfold. He's mentored several of our graduates, Carl Gobelman being one. He's taught as an adjunct in doctrinal studies and guest lectured in church history, as well as served in more recent years on our board. He's very active there. In his guest lecturing in church history, he taught on the subject of his doctoral dissertation, Karl Rahner. Rahner was an important Roman Catholic theologian at Vatican II and beyond, who taught, among other things, that non-Christians can actually be anonymous Christians. There are obvious problems with this teaching, but one wonders whether it may be rightly extended into other areas so that those who might not regard themselves as Cub fans are actually anonymous fans of the Cubs, unknowingly. But while we still have all the White Sox fans here, seriously, it is my privilege and pleasure to introduce to you as speaker tonight, Dr. Camden Busey.
Good evening. It's a pleasure to be with you tonight, and I appreciate those words about Karl Rahner. There's a lot of Karls in my life, as was mentioned. Carl Gobelman was a member of our congregation until he graduated, now has been ordained in the RCUS. I have another good friend, Dr. Carl Truman, some of you may know, and my father-in-law is named Carl as well. And just a little bonus tip, generally speaking, in the theological world, Carls with K's are not so good, and Carls with C's are just fine. So just letting you know, that's extra. Well, let us turn now to the word of the Lord here, at least as we set the context, set the stage, and turn our attention to what God may be saying to us this evening through his infallible word. Let's turn to Colossians chapter 1. I'm going to focus this evening on verses 28 through 29, but for the sake of context, we'll be reading verses 24 through 29. Colossians 1. Let's ask the Lord's blessing. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for your kindness toward us. We thank you, Lord, for giving to us a Savior, Jesus Christ. We thank you that he has become for us wisdom from God, from you. And we pray now that as we hear your word read, as the Spirit of Christ may be even working in and through this word, we ask, Lord, that we would be attentive, but also that you would enlighten our minds, renew even our wills through the working of the Spirit, and enable us to accomplish and to pursue the work that you would set before us within your kingdom. Would you bless us this evening, and especially our graduates? For we do pray in Christ's name. Amen. Colossians chapter 1, beginning at verse 24. Now I rejoice in my sufferings for your sake, and in my flesh I am filling up what is lacking in Christ's afflictions for the sake of his body, that is, the church, of which I became a minister according to the stewardship from God that was given to me for you, to make the word of God fully known, the mystery hidden for all ages, for ages and generations, but now revealed to his saints. To them God chose to make known how great among the Gentiles are the riches of the glory of this mystery, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory. Him we proclaim, warning everyone and teaching everyone with all wisdom, that we may present everyone mature in Christ. For this I toil, struggling with all his energy, that he powerfully works within me. May God bless the reading of his word. Well, it was not too long ago that I was sitting in your place, graduates and year-old graduates, and it does go by fast. It certainly does, and I want to congratulate you on your labors and on the place to which you have come for your hard work and your dedication. I also want to give thanks, as is right and fitting, to all the family members, particularly your wives, if you are married, and others within your family and within your churches who've supported you to this point. It's a true demonstration, I think, of the support that we have within the body of Christ and how we can labor alongside one another and encourage one another in our pilgrimage, in our path, ultimately to the new heavens and the new earth, to the final resting place, the consummate place where we yearn to go, that place to which Canaan pointed, that place that we still await to see our Savior face to face, ultimately when he comes again. Brothers in Christ, you have studied hard, and now it's time to go out into the fields. Now, many of you have already or will soon be entering pastoral ministry. Some of you may be serving the Lord, maybe in other ways, whether serving in churches in a variety of capacities or other supporting organizations, or even maybe by continuing your formal studies now or maybe off into the future. But whatever the case may be, not only for you, but for everyone here, in Christ, each and every one of Christ's people have a place within the kingdom of God. And more than that, each and every person in Christ has a unique measure of God's varied grace in order that he or she may carry out the work that the Lord calls you to do. We each are living stones being built into the temple of God. I like to say frequently to the people at Hope up in Grays Lake that we used to have a pallet of bricks behind the church. I don't know if you have one, but after our church was built for about 10 years, there was a pallet of leftover bricks in the back. And as you could look at that in a building project, you can take any one of those bricks, provided it wasn't damaged, and place it as the next brick in the building. But the bricks in the temple of God are not so. We're living stones, yes, but also to extend the metaphor, so to speak, and to build upon what Peter said in terms of God giving a unique measure of God's varied grace to his people. Each and every one of these bricks is unique in its shape. It has a place. And if that place in the temple is not occupied, then God has given a gift to a steward to steward that gift, and it is not being exercised for his glory. Each and every one of you, whether you're going into pastoral ministry or whatever you would find yourself to do by the Lord's direction, has a place. Now, at least for you graduates, it's tempting sometimes when you're a seminary student to think about your time at seminary as something of a parenthesis period, and not the dispensational kind. It's kind of like that, maybe in between the times, right? And already not yet. You've begun something new, a new chapter in your life, but it's not yet consummated, and you're in school, and you don't know what to make of yourself. Maybe you have friends who are outside of the church, or even non-Christian friends, and they just don't know what to make of you. Why would you leave a good-paying job and go do this? Didn't you already finish your schooling? It's hard to make sense of things. And sometimes when you're in the seminary, you don't feel like you're living in real life. Is that true? It's some other mode of existence, right? But it is real life. It is real life. Maybe it's a different gear for a few years. But you've already been about the work of the kingdom. Now, you're going to go out into those fields, yes. But you've already been at work in one way, shape, or form. You know, you've been working and serving in a local church as a member, as a volunteer, perhaps as an intern. But also you've been working and serving among Christians throughout the week, wherever you may find yourself, at the seminary, at home, maybe in a workplace. But the seminary has a special place in life, especially for the budding and future pastor. And in my understanding, Mid-America is faithful to cultivate a particular kind of spiritual maturity among its students and to direct those students to go out and to serve Christ's body. I've had involvement with a variety of seminaries, development and more and less involvement on my part. But it's very rare to see the type of connection and the type of service that Mid-America has to the local congregation. And I got to witness that as a minister who had two students within my congregation, and to see how the seminary helps to cultivate spiritual maturity and seeks to assist the church, not to replace the church, and not to give lip service to the church, but to serve the church in the carrying out of that work, of presenting, ultimately, a workman, we hope, into the future when Christ returns, a workman who's approved, and a workman who will receive a commendation through the Lord that he has been faithful and done his task. But of course, we know this fundamentally is the work of the Holy Spirit. And the Lord has promised to bring to completion the work that he has begun in each and every one of his people. That's the wonderful promise of Philippians chapter 1, verse 6. Certainly, the church is given a unique charge and a unique authority to minister to God's people. But this humble seminary supports the church in her work. I really do believe from the bottom of my heart, and in my experience, Mid-America is truly remarkable in that way. So take that to heart as you enter the next stage of your Christian pilgrimage. Remember from whence you came, where the Lord has cared for you up to this point, and I promise you that he will care for you going out from here as well, using a variety of people, using a variety of means that he directs for his glory. So with that very lengthy introduction, our text this evening, as we read, is Colossians 1, verses 28 through 29. To disclose a little bit of my own life and my own pilgrimage, I really have adopted these two verses something as a life philosophy. I'm not going to crack any code or tell you some secret interpretation of these passages or that I have some sort of a curriculum out back that you can purchase that I'll tell you all about this new program. No, but when I read these passages or these verses, and I have for some long time, I've been tremendously encouraged by the way that the Lord provides for each and every person, but especially for the minister of the gospel, as he seeks to go out and proclaim the good news of Christ crucified and raised for sinners. And he doesn't expect us to do it on our own, but he grants to us the energy and the working of the Holy Spirit to accomplish the work he wants us to do. Does it get any better than that? It's wonderful. It is glorifying. And these are my life philosophy verses, so to speak. It's on my wall in my study. My church, when I transitioned to become an evangelist, they had it done up in beautiful calligraphy, so I see it every time I go into the study. It's even our adopted mission statement at Reformed Forum, just to remind us what we are about. The Great Commission, yes, but every person should be about seeing and assisting the church in one way, shape, or form to do her job of presenting every person mature in Christ. I want to consider those two verses within their immediate context, verses 24 through 29, but also within the greater redemptive historical context. And within that larger context, the big sweep of God's work in covenant history, there's really, I believe, one big question that kind of presents itself to us. If Christ has done such a remarkable work to redeem his people from their sins, and he's been raised from the dead, he has ascended on high. Many Christians obviously will know that today is Ascension Day, right? That it's a special day. We are reminded of many of these things. The big question for us then, why are we still here? If Christ has finished his work, what are we doing? Why has he not yet come back? Well, it's because he has still given us work to do. And he has more sheep to be called into his fold. And Christ has entrusted his church with the Great Commission. He said, "Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. And behold, I am with you always to the end of the age." God has chosen his people from among all nations, and the church must take the message of Christ crucified, not just to St. John's or Sherville or as far as Nebraska, but to the ends of the earth. To the ends of the earth. And Christ gives his body, the church, the power to bring about this work, to bring this work to completion. So Paul does his work. He engages in his work through the power of the Spirit. More significantly, he certainly does not work on his own, even with the power of the Spirit. He doesn't work independently. What he does in ministry is connected to Christ, but also to the church, to Christ's body. And consider many of the words that are used in these passages. If you noticed in verses 24 through 29, there are many key verbs that Paul employs. Verbs like fill up, complete, make known, proclaim, present, and even the word striving. And to various degrees, each of these words presuppose something that has already begun. There's a connection then between the work of the ministry and the person and the work of Jesus Christ. There's also a trajectory within that, a movement, a directedness toward the completion of Christ's continued work among his body, the church. Paul is then to be considered as a steward. He has been entrusted with a great responsibility. He has been entrusted with a work, a labor, that he is to perform as a minister. Paul is indeed responsible, quote, to make the word of God fully known, end quote. And this is the mystery hidden for ages and generations, but now revealed to the saints, as Paul says in verse 26. Now, one thing you no doubt learned in your Old Testament courses is that Jesus Christ is the suffering servant of Isaiah. That's in the Old Testament, Dr. Menninger, just so you know. It's a joke from last night. I pick on my dear friend. Christ is indeed the suffering servant of Isaiah, and among his work, he has become a light to the Gentiles. Isaiah 49:6, but then, of course, picked up in Acts 13. And this work is carried out to completion by Christ's representatives, that light would go out to the Gentiles. Jesus is the light. Jesus is the Word incarnate. But who ultimately is entrusted to carry that Word and that light and to shine it in all the corners of the earth. Yes, it's the Spirit doing it, but it's entrusted to laborers to carry that work out. And God has always planned to do this. He has always had a plan to include the Gentiles. They are not a plan B. Plan A. God has elected them from before the foundations of the world. Yet, this plan, of course, was not always made manifest to the Jews prior to the coming of Christ. God revealed it in time, as he describes in Ephesians 3, as Paul does. And now Paul makes this mystery clear to the Colossians. You want to hear the mystery? Paul already told us. It's Christ in you, the hope of glory. What a wonderful mystery. Now fully revealed. This isn't a secret that you couldn't know. Mystery isn't often used in the New Testament that way, but it's speaking of this revelation, this fullness that has now come through, particularly through the resurrection of Christ and how now gloriously Jew and Gentile have been made into one new man in Jesus. Taking the two, making them into one new man and tearing down that dividing wall of hostility. And that truth, that mystery, that the gospel is for the Gentiles as well, and we now are one new man in Christ, that truth sheds brilliant, almost blinding light on Paul's emphatic statement in verse 28. Him we proclaim, warning everyone and teaching everyone with all wisdom, that we may present everyone mature in Christ. You hear that? Paul admonishes and teaches everyone. The gospel does not discriminate among people groups. It doesn't matter who you are or from where you've come, but the gospel is good news that is offered to you in and through Christ. There are not different portions that are distributed to different groups. There are no executive platinum members or gold and silver tiers within the body of Christ. We have that at the hotel, not in the church. The task of laborers within Christ's kingdom is then to present all people mature or even maybe complete in Christ. Brothers, as you reflect upon your time in seminary, I trust that you see much evidence, I hope, of your own maturity and your growth, yes, in sanctification, but also more specifically, even in knowledge and awareness of your Christ-likeness. But I know at least with some of the graduates, there might be more maturity among some than others. There are different degrees. But in using here the word for maturity, for those the scholars out here, I wouldn't do this in the church, but for you New Testament folks, this word, teleion, some scholars note that Paul is likely co-opting a technical term often used for initiates into the Colossian mystery religions. He's very polemical in his letter to the church in Colossae, speaking of the mystery, but using it in a Christian way. Now even maybe speaking of maturity, but using it in a Christian way, not in regards to initiating into a Colossian mystery religion, but for one, entering into a relationship with Christ. Well, Paul certainly had in mind much more than just entrance into the church or entrance into union with Christ. Indeed, he even said that his mission is to make the word of God fully known. Not just the basics, not just the items for the initiate, but to make it fully known. And this reference here to maturity parallels in many ways the emphasis of the Great Commission, remember, which is discipleship through baptizing and teaching. So you have baptizing as an entering in, and then teaching as a means of a whole life focus on presenting a complete and mature disciple. And Paul does this by indicating here this word, maturity, indicating initiation into Christ as well as growth in Christ. You have a part in this as a laborer in the kingdom of God. And you must join with the entire body of Christ in this energized struggle. Now, you can find shelves and shelves of books presenting the next inventive philosophy for ministry. I receive a lot of books from a lot of publishers, a lot of emails that come in the inbox describing the next program in evangelism, the next plan and program or inventive way to preach, the next way to do Christian discipleship in your church, or how to grow it in various ways. To the production of these books, of course, there is no end. And there are all manner of new methods and innovative processes for church growth and discipleship, but Paul cuts through all of this, much of these programs, with a very simple statement about his philosophy of ministry. And this is his entire purpose for living and for laboring, right there in verse 29. It says, "For this I toil, struggling with all his energy that he powerfully works within me." The word here for struggle is related to our word agonize. But wait, as you should have learned in your exegesis courses, we do not want to put undue emphasis in etymology. You thought I fell into a trap, didn't you? I might fall into another one, but that one. We don't want to put too much emphasis in etymology, and that's just the study of where our words came from. Just because our word came from a word in another language doesn't mean they mean the same thing. Our word here, the word for struggle here, is related to our word, agonize. But Paul is not using an athletic metaphor here in that sense. But it's a word often used in that context of athletics. You see, when Paul is speaking about, "For this I toil, struggling with all his energy, that he powerfully works within me," he's speaking about struggling toward a goal or the completion of something. It's a metaphor he uses elsewhere, but also is used in other portions of Scripture, much like an endurance race or a fight to the finish. And you would use all of your strength and all of your determination to arrive at the terminus point, the completion of this pilgrimage, this path. He struggles with all of his energy to present everyone mature in Christ, that he would arrive at the same maturity and that same terminus point that they would. He struggles much like an endurance runner would. Some of you know I like to run, and this morning I got up and went to go run on the treadmill, but it was occupied, so I just took off. I just ran out the door and started running down Calumet Avenue, not the middle of it, but on the sidewalk, and I kept running and running and running, and I came all the way down to the Tell at Centennial Park, and I saw that great staircase leading up to the top of that hill, and I thought, I'm going to run with all my energy to the top of that hill. And I did, much like Rocky. You could call me Munster Rocky. You know, Rocky was a boxer running to the top of the stairs of the Philadelphia Museum of Art, but Munster Rocky is an OPC minister running to the top of a landfill. So. Both are a struggle. And both could be used as a metaphor, as humble as that might have been, rather than triumphant. Nobody was filming me. Nevertheless, you get that illustration, right? Running with all your energy to arrive at the terminus point, the top, the goal, the finish line. You're engaging in that as a follower of Christ, but even more specifically and uniquely as ministers of the gospel, as laborers within his church. The good news of the gospel is that you do not struggle alone. No, Christ is with you by his Spirit, and Christ is your life. If Colossians 1, 28 through 29 is sort of my life philosophy, and I think to some degree Paul's, then Galatians 2, 20 is what makes it possible. I have been crucified with Christ. And it is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. And the life I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. Christ gives us the strength to live. He also gives us the strength to serve and to accomplish his will, namely by giving us the Holy Spirit, God himself. And this Christ-centered life dynamic is captured so well in Augustine's famous quotation, "Grant what thou commandest and command what thou dost desire." God commands us to do things, brothers, that are impossible. Impossible in our own strength. But he gives to us his Spirit to accomplish that same work. As Paul says in Philippians 2, 12 and 13, "Work out your own salvation with fear and trembling, for it is God who works in you, both to will and to work for his good pleasure." Christ's power allows us to rise above our limitations. He designs it that way so frequently so that we would not rely on our own strength and be reminded that we labor in the Lord, and to him be the glory. And understanding that, and then also coming to a place of deep spiritual contentment in the Lord, no matter where he would place you, and no matter what circumstances he gives to you, places you within, you can say along with Paul in Philippians 4, "I can do all things through him who strengthens me." Brothers, the finish line is ahead. Our Lord is returning one day. He will be here. But even now, you have the hope of glory. And Christ is bringing you to that glorious day when he will return on the clouds, when we all will be raised imperishable in the Lord. That will be the day when everyone, every single person who trusts in Christ alone for their salvation will be presented as mature in him, complete, perfect. Strive for that. Struggle for it with all the energy which he so mightily and abundantly gives to you. For Christ gives his body the power to bring his work to completion. Amen. Let's pray. Our Father in heaven, we thank you for the great work of our Savior Jesus, and we thank you that that work is not complete. And by that, we do not mean that he hasn't paid fully for our sins with his death on the cross, or that somehow there's something missing, or that he forgot to do something. But he's raised on high, even interceding for us now and forever will. But Lord, yet you have more people to be called. And we pray that your Spirit would go forth through the Word, through the means of grace, and we pray, Lord, that wherever we find ourselves or whoever we are, that we would take up our place within this household of faith, within the church, and that we would put to use with great joy and great diligence the grace that you have entrusted to us. Father, give us contentment in this and help us to strive to see that Lord, to see Christ, that you would receive all the glory, honor, and praise, for you are worthy. Amen.
Before we join together in singing, allow me to thank you, Dr. Busey, for those words of exposition, of encouragement that these men themselves, by Christ's Spirit, be enabled to become mature in Christ, but also as his instruments by the Spirit be used of God in the maturing of his whole people in conformity to the Lord Jesus Christ. We're going to join now in singing. The song is printed in the bulletin or the program, "Lead On, O King Eternal," and let's stand together as we sing.
Fields of love, blessed thy
As you know, due to the circumstances last year, when we were only able to have for the class of 2020 a very modest, only the wives could attend, not even the children, not any of the other students, not friends from afar. We've come a ways. We can be thankful that we're here together this evening. But we had told the students, the class of 2020, that we were going to invite them to join this year's class, Lord willing, to participate in a more traditional commencement exercise. And there were 7 graduates last year. All of their names are printed in the program. And 3 of them are able to be with us this evening. Now, I'll read the names of the 4 who are not with us in a moment, but there are 3 who are present. 2, just for your information, of last year's students had planned to come, but they're in Canada, and under the circumstances decided they were unable to do so. The other 2 students were also hoping to come. 1, however, took a call, by God's grace, to a church out east, and that prevented him from coming. Another, whose pastoral supervisor is here because he was going to surprise the student, Christian Garcia, by the congregation's generosity. Unhappily, in the Lord's providence, their young boy, Judah, had a serious accident and is under medical care. So if my math is correct, all 7 really did aspire to be here, but we have 3 representatives. So what we're going to do in just a moment, but there's something else intervening, is invite that class to stand first, the 3 of them, and they'll proceed in the receiving of their diploma. Though you'll notice that they're hooded. They have the academic regalia that signifies and confirms that they're already more mature than the class of 2021. So we're not going to re-hood them. But we will ask them to come across the stage, receive a diploma that they'd previously received, and receive the congratulatory handshake of 2 representatives of the faculty, Dr. Beach and Dr. Minninger. The class of 2021 will be treated distinctly and with all of the customary circumstances, including the conferral, or the placing, vesting of them with the insignia of their accomplishment. But before we proceed to that, I said there was something intervening. It's been a long-standing tradition at Mid-America to take note of the wives of our graduates who fully shared in, some of them for the entire period of their study, some only a shorter period, but nonetheless most significant. When one becomes in Christ, husband and wife, we have all things in common, and we submit to one another out of reverence for Christ. And I know these brothers more directly and properly than I would express something along these lines, but we do give thanks to God for each of the wives, for their contributions too many to count, without which not these brothers would not be able to be the men they are and to receive the degrees they'll receive this evening. So let me read the names of the wives of last year's graduates and then also of this year's graduates. In the case of last year's, I'll read their names, but they're not all of them here. In fact, of the 3 students here, 1 of them was unable for his wife to come with him from last year's class, if I'm correct. And so the wives of last year's class are Greta DeYoung. She's here, and if she would, please stand and remain standing. And Carolina Garcia is not here. Carice Gephardt, who I believe is here. And then Linda Gobelman, Liz Hamstra, Jesse LeVere, and Vanessa White. And then for this year's graduates, it's Rachel Dick. Rachel would stand. Dana Stafford. And Carissa Vanderheiden. Let's acknowledge their contribution. to sit. Your husbands have probably told you Dr. Venema doesn't know when to stop, so I'll live up to my reputation. I happen to be a PK, a preacher's kid, so I've lived in the home of a pastor together with my mother, his wife. This is just an illustration of a significant contribution. My father was a somewhat impetuous, sometimes impulsive fellow, and I heard not a few times through the years as a little child growing up in our home, count to 10. And he, most of the time, wisely heeded her counsel. That's only a small snippet of the very rich and significant way in which you can be a counselor and a helper, even a corrector, and in too many ways to identify a partner with your husbands in the work of the ministry. So we thank you. You may be seated. So I invite now the president of the Board of Trustees, Reverend Jim Sawtelle, to come forward for the presentation, first to the class of 2020. Reverend Jim Sawtelle, on behalf of the faculty of Mid-America Reformed Seminary, it gives me great pleasure to present to you as president of the Board of Trustees the following men who have satisfactorily completed the requirements established by the Board of Trustees for the degree of Master of Divinity. Elijah Knox DeYoung. Carrie Robin Gephardt. Carl Frederick Gobelman. I invite the class of 2021 to stand. Reverend Jim Sawtelle, on behalf of the faculty of Mid-America Reformed Seminary, it gives me great pleasure to present to you, as president of the Board of Trustees, the following men who have satisfactorily completed the requirements established by the Board of Trustees for the degree of Master of Divinity. David Michael Dick. David, blessings. James Moore Stafford. Congratulations, blessings, Jim. Aaron Michael Vanderheiden. want to ask the class of 2020 to stand as you brothers join them so that all of you can receive from us an appropriate acknowledgement of this accomplishment.
I invite all of you to join me in the litany for commencement as that's printed in your programs. We praise and thank you, Heavenly Father, for lavishing your glorious riches on Mid-America Reformed Seminary and on this graduation class. We thank you for years of increase, for decades of development and maturing. We thank you for students who hunger for the knowledge of your will and purposes. For professors and administrators, nurture and lead. For supporters and constituents, to whom you have given the wisdom of your glorious kingdom, and of the tasks we can do for the King. For prophetic voices to warn, chasten, and correct when we lose our way. For graduates whose lives of joyful service and liberating obedience testify of the kingdom come. In times and ways and places far beyond our best planning and our boldest hopes. We thank you, Lord, for your great faithfulness, and we praise you for the lives and graduates we honor today. We thank you today for the strength you give us through the Spirit, for the gift of Christ dwelling in our hearts and lives and churches, and for the communion of all the saints to whom we catch a glimpse of how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ. On this glad day, we praise your name, O God, to the God who has already graced our lives with vision, sacrifice, and learning. We come with this bold plea, kindness, joy, salvation.
Some years ago, we added to our graduation commencement exercises a charge annually for each class by one of the professors in the way of a rotation. And this year, it's fallen to me. And the students are already in some dread and fear that we may have a second commencement address. And so I begin with what may not prove to be a reliable promise. A charge is to be short and to the point and not unduly long. So I'll give it to you in short form and then I might elaborate just a little. but I'm going to read very familiar words for all of these students. I wouldn't doubt that you spent some time even exegeting the passage in your first year course in homiletics, and it's in Romans 10, and I'm going to begin reading at verse 13 and stop at verse 17. For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. How then will they call on him of whom they have not believed? And how are they to believe in him of whom they have never heard? And how are they to hear without someone preaching? And how are they to preach unless they are sent? As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of those who preach the good news. But they have not all obeyed the gospel, for Isaiah says, Lord, who has believed what he has heard from us? So faith comes from hearing, and hearing through the word of Christ. Note especially the apostle's quotation from Isaiah 52:7. How beautiful are the feet of those who preach the good news. And here's the short form of the charge. May those who hear the good word of Christ, Christ himself speaking, and the good word about Christ, the gospel word, the gospel message through you, by the Spirit's work brought to faith, may they say of your feet, they were beautiful. For beautiful are the feet of those who come preaching the good news. Now, these students are very well-trained hermeneutically. They know the apostle is using a metaphor, more precisely a metonomy, where you capture something by referring to something characteristic that lies at the heart of it. A literal reading would say you need to go before you enter the ministry and have a pedicure so that your feet might be lovely, even if you're wearing merely sandals. People can see them and they're not put off. I have no idea, happily, what your literal feet look like. As the great commentator Calvin says regarding this verse, it's a metonomy for the arrival of someone who has something precious, something that gladdens the heart, something that grants a fullness of joy, a message better than any message conveyed today, not by feet and by those who sure-footedly and swift-footedly run over the mountains and through the valleys. It's a marathon in order to bring you, to announce to you, the good news of Jesus Christ. You can send as many tweets as you wish. Look at as many Facebook posts or Instagram, or, you know, I'm always five methods of media behind the times, being an old person. You see, the Apostle Paul is appealing to Isaiah's, in the Book of Comfort, prophecy of the restoration of Israel from exile. You're going to be set free. Your God, who is the God of all creation, whose promises never fall to the ground empty, will restore you to favor. He'll end your warfare. He'll cover your sins. He'll bring you back into renewed communion with himself. And that's only a foretaste, says the apostle, of what God has done for his people in Christ. Having been put to death for their sins, having been raised for their justification. Beautiful are the feet of the herald, the language for preach, has embedded in it the idea of a herald. And you all know about heralds. They would run on behalf of the king, or whomever authorized them to bring the message that they entrusted to them, and announce in the public square good news of great joy, so that the hearts of the people who believe their report would be gladdened. Now, you know the context. Paul has, he actually uses six verbs, and he creates an unbroken chain. You're all familiar with how in Romans 8 you have that golden chain, thinks Perkins. Those whom he foreknew, he also called. Those whom he called, he also justified. Those whom he justified, he also glorified. Inseparably and inextricably bound together. Paul has said in the context, as he unburdens his heart, he starts chapter 10 by saying, my heart's desire and prayer to God is that they may be saved. Of whom is he speaking? His kinsmen according to the flesh, many of whom have stumbled at the good message of the gospel, pursuing righteousness and acceptance with God by their own works rather than by the work of another, namely the Lord Jesus Christ. And it's in this context that he says, only those who believe with their heart and confess with their mouth that God has raised Jesus from the dead will be saved. But how can they believe if no one is sent? No one whom the church sends declares the good message, the good news. How can they call upon the name of the Lord if they have not heard Christ speak for and about himself through you? How can they call upon the name of the Lord and so be saved? Now, I could accent one implication of that. You're going on a mission in Christ's church if you be sent, authorized, commissioned, where everything really does hang in the balance. Unless through you and those like you, the message is voiced and published, heralded, how can they be expected to call upon the name of the Lord in faith and so be saved? But I want to accent back to the metaphor, the metanomy, beautiful are the feet of those. That's a test, brothers, as to whether you're a good gospel minister. The principal first and last word of your preaching is not your sinners who need to do more. You're falling so far short that it's possible that you are beyond the reach of God's grace. Or perhaps even worse, like those who pursued righteousness according to the law, this is what you have to do to make yourself presentable to God. There's a lot of preaching like that in Reformed churches even. We call it moralism, legalism. This is what you have to do in order to be saved. Your feet will only be beautiful if you come with a better message, the best possible message. Christ has done what is needed. He has ended, taken the sting out of the law by his obedience in the place of his people. So you're trumpeting, you're telling people, when you arrive, in a manner of speaking, behind the pulpit, you're driven by the desire to have feet that are beautiful. You know, you could use all kind of analogies. I don't know what the best report you've ever heard in your life that's come to you through the U.S. snail mail or by way of a courier that gladdened your heart. Maybe there are people here tonight who have a son or a daughter in the armed forces. There are such people. The officer comes to the door and he says, I have bad news. Your son, your daughter was killed in action. Now that's the antithesis of what happens when there's a knock at the door and it's the best possible news. Your son is alive. He's well. He's coming home. And so, brothers, my charge to you is this. Ask yourself the question. Now, you preach the whole counsel of God. You also warn, you admonish, you call to new obedience. Don't misunderstand me.
But at the end of the day, will they say of my feet, they were beautiful? It was a thing that made glad my heart once more. In the house of the Lord, or in the field, or in the square, or over the table, or wherever it is that you can tell others the good message of Christ and his saving work. That's my charge. Beautiful, how beautiful are the feet of those who preach the good news. The good news.
Let's stand together as we pray. Our gracious God and our Heavenly Father, we see in your word that you have described how what no eye has seen, nor ear heard, nor the mind of man imagined, this is what you have prepared for those who love you. We are grateful, Father, that you have revealed this to us and given us this otherworldly wisdom, a wisdom not available in this world, but revealed only in your word. Christ in us, the hope of glory. The hope of glory through the cross, through the crucified and resurrected one, Jesus Christ, now within us by the Spirit whom he has poured out. Father, we pray this evening that you would give these graduates an ever-increasing measure of this Spirit, the otherworldly Spirit. Give them, Father, we pray, no other wisdom. In fact, we ask that you would take away from them every other supposed wisdom or hope, every other pretense of wisdom or hope other than this, the crucified and resurrected Lord Jesus Christ in us, the hope of glory. Father, help these men to marvel in this. Help them to be caught up in it, to be captivated by it. We pray that you would nourish and strengthen their hearts all of their days in this message, this wisdom, this hope. And may we ask this same wisdom overflow from them to others. We pray that you would convert, that you would guide, that you would equip others through them, this message that they're being given. Spread the vision of this same wisdom and hope to your people throughout the world, that it may grow up, this entire people, into the maturity of Jesus Christ. And may he, our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the firstborn over all creation, the firstborn from the dead, be greatly glorified by these graduates and in these graduates, by all of us and in all of us. We ask this in Christ's own name. Amen.